In the last regular week of matches this wrestling season, Spencer Lee got pinned, Yianni remained number one, and I have a couple inspirational wrestling stories to share. So let's stop stalling and start talking wrestling. Hello and welcome to the Fanco Wrestling Show. My name is Josiah and on this channel I talk all about wrestling news, tips, and lifestyle. If you're interested in those topics, make sure you subscribe. Today we're talking all about the last week in college wrestling, which was pretty spectacular. The Oklahoma State versus Iowa match was probably the biggest match of the year, and we'll get to that in just a bit. Make sure you check down in the comments and in the description for all the links and helpful show notes that you can skip ahead to your favorite topics. Let's get right into the discussion today. Spencer Lee got pinned. Now, this is the first time that this has happened to Spencer Lee since 2009, whenever he was wrestling in the Pennsylvania Junior Tournament. So I'm going to go all into the discussion with the past weekend's match, Oklahoma State versus Iowa. Let's get right into this and jump into 125 pounds. Now, of course, this was a big match, not only for Iowa, but also for Oklahoma State. Oklahoma State is undefeated this season, and so was Iowa until Oklahoma State handed them their first loss. The Cowboys looked spectacular in the match. Now, the match ended up 27-12 Oklahoma State, and there were some really great marquee matches. These two teams, 17 ranked wrestlers between them. There were 13,000 fans in Oklahoma State's arena, and it was really just a phenomenal duel all around. So Oklahoma State will remain undefeated at 15-0 this dual meet season. But as for the matches, Spencer Lee, of course, he wrestled Nick Piccinini. And Piccinini is the number four ranked kid in the country right now. At this point, he'll probably jump up to two or three after pinning Spencer Lee. This was a great way to start off the match. I mean, to be honest with you, Spencer Lee looked like he was, I don't want to say he was in control, but this match could have went either way up until the pin in the second period. Now, he ended up getting pinned, you know, in that second period after he shot in on Piccinini. Piccinini took him in that near side cradle, cranked him over, and that was it, with about 10 seconds left in the second period, 10, 15 seconds left. And, I mean, Piccinini just looked like he was on fire, and he was pumped up after that match, as he should be. Spencer Lee has, I don't want to say he has been struggling this season, because he hasn't. He had a tough match against the number one ranked kid, Sebastian Rivera. And then he had, you know, this match this past week against Piccinini. And, you know, it's tough for him. And he's going to now, he's got to win that conference championship. He's got to win Big Ten and hope for a decent seeding at Nationals. He's going to run into one of these guys, depending on, you know, what the seedings end up at Nationals. He's going to run into one of them in the quarters or most likely the semis. And people are gunning for him this year. And you know, though he has a pretty great record, you know, Piccinini, he's 28-0 right now. What a record. I mean, that's, and like I said, this is the first time Lee has been pinned since the 2009 Pennsylvania Junior Wrestling Tournament. What is up with that? Hopefully he can pull it together for the rest of the season. He's still my number one pick for a national champion, but Piccinini, great work. Let's move on to 133 pounds. We had Austin DeSanto versus Dayton Fix. This was the other marquee match of the night, and it did not let down. Oklahoma State kept rolling along, and Fix ended up beating DeSanto. He beat him 2-0, so it was a little bit of an uneventful match. You know, there were some great shots, great battles, a couple scrambles, but for the most part, where the match really cranked up was the third period. So Fix was up one zip on DeSanto, and DeSanto took bottom. And as we know, Fix is great with the legs, and that's just, he threw those boots in with 5 seconds into the third period, and he ended up riding DeSanto out. Now, DeSanto was pretty close, actually, at the end of the match to getting a reversal, and he was close to an escape a couple times, but just couldn't get out of Fix's grasp. And that just shows what a great wrestler, Dayton Fix is, that he can ride this guy out for, he had over 3 minutes of riding time, I believe is what it ended up, or no, 2 minutes riding time is what it ended up. But, one big thing that happened this match was whenever Fix basically choked DeSanto. I mean, it was like a rear naked choke right there. It was pretty bizarre to see him doing that because, obviously Fix is aggressive. And I think what this really comes back to is a lot of guys are out there, they're gunning for DeSanto. They want to see him fall and fail because of his antics on and off the mat. Now, DeSanto was well kept after this match. He didn't do anything bad or unsportsmanlike. It was just, I lost. I got that loss handed to me, and I got to find a way to win. And, hopefully he carries that throughout the rest of the season. And this really just cranks up 133 pounds even more because now Fix, he actually has a loss to Mickey Philippi, and he is, although he has 9 wins over ranked opponents. Now, DeSanto also, he has a loss to Austin Gomez. And this has just been going all around the entire weight. Guys beating each other and beating each other, losing each other. Everything's just a mess right now at 133 pounds. The only person that's kind of out of the clear a little bit is Stefan Micic, because he's just ahead of the curve because he hasn't wrestled a couple of these guys, and the guys that he has wrestled, like a Suriano, like a Pletcher, he's handled them pretty well. So he's sitting pretty clean right now. The match, so Oklahoma State, they were up pretty big right then, 9-0. Going into 141 pounds, where Max Murin was wrestling number 14, Cade Brock of Oklahoma State. And Brock ended up getting the decision on Murin. He beat him 8-6. There were some nice scrambles in this match, but, nothing too spectacular. But a nice win for Cade Brock of Oklahoma State. Moving on to 149 pounds was another good match against ranked wrestlers. You had number 11, Pat Lugo of Iowa versus number 6, Caden Gefeller of Oklahoma State. Now, Lugo ended up getting the win in that match. He won 7-4. And this is another match that it was going back and forth, back and forth, back and forth through takedowns and escapes. And the scrambles there were pretty nice. What Gefeller did really well, and he's been doing well all season, is his ability to reverse guys whenever he's on bottom and get that two. And he did that once to Lugo, and that helped him, score some points there. Unfortunately, he did end up with the loss, and he also had a loss to Brock Mahler last week. So this actually ended up getting some points for the Hawkeyes on the board, but a pretty solid match all around. Going into 157 pounds, we had number 7, Caleb Young, versus Wyatt Sheets from Oklahoma State. Sheets is an unranked wrestler, and Caleb Young's number 7. Nothing too crazy to talk about here. Young ended up getting the decision 112-6 and helped the Hawkeyes to increase the score. So at this point in the match, we're thinking, the Hawkeyes, Iowa could be mounting a comeback. It's tough to come back after that deficit of the Spencer Lee pin, which would swing the match, or could swing the match, the momentum, and the score. But at this point, we get into 165 pounds. No intermission during this match. We just had straight wrestling, wrestled straight through, which made the match go pretty quick, in my opinion. But we had number 2, Alex Marinelli, versus Blaylock of Oklahoma State. Now, this match, Marinelli ended up getting the fall, and this is big for Iowa here. And Marinelli, he's just showed dominance the entire year. His ability to take these guys down and turn them over, get points on top, it has proven that he should be that number 2 ranked wrestler. And I know some people are arguing that maybe he should be the number 1 ranked wrestler because Tenzo hasn't wrestled Marinelli or Wick, who's the number 3 guy at 165 pounds. Chenzo still deserves to be at the top. He's a two-time returning national champion, but Marinelli's gunning for him, and he'll be out there for him at Big Tens. And as we move on to 174 pounds, this is where we have Mitch Bowman versus number 11 Chandler Rogers. And at this point in the match, it was kind of strange with a couple of the weight changes, because Chandler Rogers is working his way down to 165 pounds. And then at 184 pounds, we also had Jacoby Smith, who's working his way down to 174 pounds. They'll be down there at the lower weights for the postseason, but in this match, they weighed in lighter, which kind of, you know, it hurt them a little bit because they're giving up weight, but in this match, they had to wrestle up just because of the plan with John Smith's plan. But with Mitch Bowman versus Chandler Rogers, Rogers ended up getting the fall, which was pretty solid. Rogers is a senior from Oklahoma State, and he had quite possibly the longest celebration I've ever seen. When he pinned Bowman, he gets up just like, oh, you know, another job, another day on the job. But he is a senior, so that's kind of why he was doing that crazy celebration at the end of the match. It continued right after the pin, after the handshake, after he had his hand raised. He was celebrating the whole time, but good for Chandler Rogers. Going into 184 pounds, we had Cash Wilkie versus number 11, Jacoby Smith from Oklahoma State. Of course, Wilkie is from Iowa. Smith ended up getting that decision on Wilkie 6-3. Had some solid takedowns. He really just was in control the entire match. And, you know, he will be a force to be reckoned with at Nationals, especially when he bumps down a weight. You know, Jacoby Smith just looked jammed, you know, right out there on the mat. And he's had some nice wins this year. Of course, he beat Drew Foster, and also Drew Foster, which has helped him. You know, he's a top guy in the weight class, 184 pounds. And I believe he has a win over Nino Bonacorsi as well, who is another tough guy at that weight. But now that he's bumping down, that opens the weight up just a little bit, but it is still one of the toughest weight classes this year for sure. At 197 pounds, Iowa at this point, they needed to score some bonus points in order to potentially pull out the win. However, Weigel of Oklahoma State ended up getting that decision on Warner. He won the match 5-3. Warner, of course, is a redshirt freshman, while Weigel is, I believe he's a senior as well. He remains undefeated on the season and had over 3 minutes of riding time during this match. He's a force to be reckoned with on top. Now, the thing about this match is Weigel, for whatever reason, now he's the number 6 kid in the country, Warner is number 4, so it was an upset here, but Weigel was pretty much giving up the match in the second and third period. He kept getting these horrible call, and not horrible from the refs, but horrible, like, why are you doing this? He got a locked hands call, he got a caution point, and then I believe he even got a hands to the face call, and he just kept kind of stalling a little bit, not doing too much. And I understand he wanted to hold on to that, to his points, get that win on senior night, get that win over the guy who's ranked ahead of him. But when you're up like that, you have to keep going after your opponent. You have to keep the offensive going, or you're going to get hit with that stall call. So, you know, that's that there. But it did secure the win for Oklahoma State. And at 285 pounds, we had probably, you know, this match, like I said, flew up until this point. And then at heavyweight, we had probably the longest match of the night, just because these guys kept going out of bounds. You had number 7, Sam Stoll from Iowa, and number 2, Derek White from Oklahoma State. Now, these guys are both tough ranked wrestlers. Stoll right now, he's 8-2. White is 23-1. His lone loss on the season is to Gable Stevenson, who's number 1 true freshman at the weight class. So his loss, he actually had a loss to Stoll as well in 2018, which is interesting, because he ended up switching the tide here. Derek White ended up getting that, pulling out the win And like I said, Oklahoma State pulled out the duel. They won the duel 27-12 and are undefeated on the season. And, you know, incredible match. Make sure you comment below, what was your favorite match? And, you know, are you excited for the postseason to see a couple of these guys? But let me know what your favorite match was in the comments below. Moving on to the next topic. Yianni Diakomopoulos versus Joey McKenna. Number one versus number three at 141 pounds happened this past weekend. This was on Friday night. And of course, you know, one of the biggest matches of the weekend, you couldn't stream it anywhere. It wasn't on Flow Wrestling. It wasn't on ESPN. The only place you could watch it was on ESPN Plus, which is ESPN's streaming platform. I'll get to that in a bit. But I was able to find a cell phone recording of the match, which is uploaded to YouTube. If you want to watch this match, I actually linked to it in the comments below. It is a vertical video, but I got to see the match, so I was pretty excited. And I'm glad that I got to see this match because it was pretty exciting. Now, Yianni pulled out the win. He won 7-5 over McKenna. Now, McKenna is coming off a loss to a guy who was ranked a lot lower than him, Nick Lee. Nick Lee right now is number two at 141 pounds. Lee from Penn State. McKenna, now, let me take you through this match a little bit. Now, Yianni is the returning national champion. And in the first period, he hits deep in on a shot. They get into a couple scrambles. And, you know, these guys are both flexible. They're both able to work in and out of position. But Yianni just got really deep. And McKenna was kind of flipping around whenever Yianni had him. And he's just trying to get out of it. I thought McKenna was actually going to come out with the takedown. Yianni ended up getting it. McKenna got the escape, and then Yianni got another takedown. In the second period, McKenna got deep in on a shot and was not able to finish that. And then he actually, whenever Yianni had him down in the second period, he got the reversal on him, which was pretty exciting, which ended up being like really close to the edge of the mat. And McKenna ended up, you know, getting the score closer. It was 7-5 with a couple takedowns by Yianni and escapes. And what ended up happening is Yianni won the match. He remains number one at 141 pounds. As for the rest of the dual meet with Cornell and Ohio State, Ohio State won that dual meet 25-9, 9 points for Cornell. So this other big matches, I guess, were Chaz Tucker at 133 pounds. He, an unranked guy from Cornell, beat number six Luke Pletcher. So this is another loss for Luke Pletcher this season, which is kind of unfortunate to see. I enjoy watching him wrestle. He's a Pennsylvania guy from Latrobe, but he had that loss in sudden victory against Chaz Tucker. Another big win was for Miles Martin over Max Dean of Cornell. He beat him 13-6, which, you know, Miles Martin is, I don't think he's getting enough credit this season right now, because 184 pounds is probably the second toughest weight class. Some may argue it's the toughest weight class. I think 33 is the toughest. Let me know, what do you think is the toughest weight class this year in NCAAs? But Miles Martin, he is able to pull off that win against ranked opponents, and that really helped him and Ohio State secure that match. So this is an awesome match to watch. And like I said, check in the description below so you can watch the full video. On to the next topic. Let's talk about Wyoming. Wyoming, like, why am I bringing up Wyoming? What have they done this year? Well, I think Wyoming wrestling is really on the rise. And if you're a Wyoming wrestling fan, good for you, because the program has been on the up and up. And I'm bringing this topic up because there was an article, which I'll link to in the description below, talking about how this is a historic record-setting season for Wyoming. And that's because it is the most wins in a single season under the coach, Mark Branch. And Branch has been the coach since 2008. This season, Wyoming pulled out a record 16 wins. They were 16-4 this year. So that was a pretty great year in dual meets. I mean, 20 meets, but 16-4 was a solid record for Wyoming. And Mark Branch, in his career, In his career, he's 116-53. That's his career dual meet record. This is actually not the most wins for Wyoming in the history of the program. They had 17 wins back in 1967, which that seems like a lot of wins for a lot of dual meets for back in the day. However, why I think this is so impressive. So let's look at the records of Wyoming over the past couple of years. So over the past couple of years, 2018, the record was 13-3. Year before that, 7-8. In 2016, the team was 6-6, and this was the first year that Wyoming joined the Big 12. They were actually formerly in the Western Wrestling Conference. And then in 2015, they were 11-4. So, you know, each year they're putting out pretty good records, other than 2016 when they were 6-6, and 2017 when they were 7-8. But this season, 16 wins. So who did they add to their roster? And then I'll get to why I think the program is on such a rise. And I think that there's a distinct reason why. But they added Air Force, Cornell, Edinburgh, Michigan State, NC State, Virginia, and West Virginia to their out-of-conference schedule. What's interesting about this is a lot of these other powerhouse schools, I'm talking Penn State, Iowa, Oklahoma State. Penn State had 13 dual meets this year. Iowa had 15, and Oklahoma State had 15 or 16 dual meets. And Wyoming had 20. So, you know, adding those extra matches really helps them get into the schedule and get some great competition. Now, what Mark Brandt said is he thinks that everything this season with his record, I'm going to read a direct quote from him. He said, "I think that's a great sign of the future. Those things don't just automatically happen every year." And he's talking about, of course, the dual meet wins, the amount of wins he gets. "So we've got to get better. But at the same time, with so many new faces in the lineup, there were a lot of unknowns, and this team really put together a solid dual season. This team just beat a bunch of quality teams in North Carolina, NC State, Michigan State, as well as others." And they do have a pretty solid lineup. They have Cole Werner, who's a ranked guy at 125 pounds. Montori Bridges, who's ranked at 133. He's number 14 in the country. Sam Turner at 141 is ranked. Branson Ashworth is number 8. He's actually their highest ranked wrestler right now this season as a senior at 165 pounds. They have Hayden Hastings and Tate Samuelson at 174 and 184 pounds respectively, who are also ranked in the country. And the reason that I believe the team is doing so well, it's one name for you, Bryce Meredith. And Bryce Meredith is just a great liaison for the sport. He is great for the sport of wrestling. And of course, Bryce Meredith is a multiple time national finalist. Unfortunately, he never got his national title. He lost last year to Yianni at 141 pounds. But he did have one of the greatest matches in the history of college wrestling in the probably what's considered the first ever super match whenever he wrestled Seth Gross, who bumped up to wrestle him last year. They put their records on the line, laid it all out there, and it grew the sport of wrestling. It got excitement. And two programs that aren't your traditional wrestling or even sports programs in Wyoming and South Dakota State, those aren't, you know, the first schools you think of when you think of wrestling. But Bryce Meredith is bringing his name, what he's able to do in learning about, you know, the coach, because a big name is what brings kids into the program. A lot of times is you see success from a guy like Bryce Meredith, who was a solid guy in high school, but really stepped it up. You know, when's the last time we heard of a guy from Wyoming making it into the national finals? Now you got a bunch of ranked wrestlers in a pretty solid recruiting class. In their recruiting class for this upcoming year, they have 3 Fargo titles, 15 All-American, high school All-American honors, and 4 guys who are ranked in the top 15 in their weight classes in the country. They have Brooks Baker, who's a heavyweight. He's number 9 right now at heavyweight. He's a 2-time state champion from Missouri. Now, a lot of these guys, they're coming from the Midwest, but there's a little bit more of a reach this year from what I've found. You know, you have your Oklahomas, Colorados, Utahs, Wyoming's, of course. But you also have this other guy, a couple other guys coming in from Missouri and Wisconsin. And even they have somebody from Pennsylvania, from Bethlehem Catholic, actually, who's wrestling for them now. And, of course, that really goes down to recruiting, and that's what makes a great program. Great recruiting, great coaching. As well as Brooks Baker, there's also Stephen Buchanan, who's at 197 pounds. And there is Jake Shivel at 133, who's number 13 in the country. So I believe that Wyoming is on the up and up. And I really hope that, you know, we see a lot of other good, solid, successful guys come out of this program that the Coach Mark Branch, as well as Bryce Meredith, helped build up. And it, all around, it's just phenomenal for the sport of wrestling. On to the next topic. Let's talk about an inspirational story, and I want to talk first about Jay Spencer. So Jay Spencer is a legally blind wrestler. He's from the state of Alabama, and he most recently won a state championship in his senior year. So a blind wrestler wins a state championship? That's crazy. Now, let me read you a couple of facts about Spencer. Spencer is a senior at John Paul High School. It's a prep school in Huntsville, Alabama. So he's a school down south, which unfortunately there's no wrestling colleges at Alabama, which, you know, I talk about in another video talking about SEC wrestling teams. But in the state of Alabama, he's now a state champ. Now, he is legally blind. He was diagnosed with a disease at the age of 3. He's able to see, if he tilts his head a little bit, he can see out of his left eyes, is what he said. But it's really, really tough for him to see. I mean, he's legally blind. He says he won the Class A 160-pound title in Alabama. And this was the Class 1A through 5A championships in Alabama. That's how it works in Alabama. If you're from another state, there are 1 through 5A, then there's 6A, then there's 7A. And Jay Spencer won the 1 through 5A division, which is the lowest division, but, you know, not knocking that at all. It's pretty incredible that he can win this. Now, what Jay Spencer said whenever he was interviewed was that wrestling was actually the easiest sport for him. Not something you hear about wrestling much, that it's an easy sport. But think about it. If he goes out for a football team, which I believe he may have, he goes out for the football team, you're out there and you have to know where the ball is. You have to know where the guy is that you're blocking. You have to, you know how to do that. If you're playing soccer, how are you going to play soccer if you're legally blind? But in wrestling, because, you know, you're grabbing that guy and you're, you know, looking to gain position on him, take a shot, ride him, whatever it is, you kind of have him, I was about to say, in your sights, but you know where he is because of you're able to grab him because of your other senses. And that's what Jay Spencer is able to do, and that's why it's easy for him. I actually had a friend on my high school wrestling team who, he wasn't blind or anything, but he had glasses, and whenever he wrestled, he basically wrestled with his eyes shut, and, you know, I'd be wrestling him in the room, and he'd just be taking shots or whatever, and once this guy won, that's the first thing I instantly thought of, was this guy from my high school who basically did the same thing. Now, there are people knocking him in the comments that I saw in a couple of videos, and you can see the news article and video I linked to in the description, but a couple of people were knocking him, saying, if you lose to a blind kid, what does that say about you as a wrestler? Let's stop that. Let's start building Spencer up and giving him the props that he deserves. The other thing is, not only is he, you know, a blind state champ, you know, he's a state champion. That is an honor not many people reach in their wrestling career. But he's a state champion from the state of Alabama. So phenomenal, phenomenal story in Jay Spencer. Good luck to you in your future. Another wrestling story, a story I want to talk about now, is a story of a 6-year-old. And this story is from Nick Trotter. He is a wrestler from Missouri. And this is it's a heartwarming story. Now, Nick Trotter from Missouri, he was born with no feet and no one hand. And so and he's wrestling. And much like Jay Spencer, who I talked about a little bit earlier, you know, Nick Trotter is out here to win and have a good time. Now, at 6 years old compared to high school or college, it's a little bit more fun atmosphere. But this kid, he's from Illinois. I'm sorry, he's not from Missouri. He's from Illinois. But he's on a mission. He was from Ukraine originally. He was adopted from the family in Illinois, and they brought him in, and he tried a couple different sports, baseball, swimming, and he still does those, and, you know, props to Nick for that. But he also wrestles, and the reason that he wrestles, and this is probably the most heartwarming part of this, is whenever he was asked, you know, a lot of people say they're inspired by Nick and his story and what he did and what he's doing. But he's not saying he's out there to change lives or anything, and nor would you expect that from a six-year-old. But he says, and I'm quoting him here, he says, "It's because I thought I would make a few new friends. So I did." And, you know, that's just such a nice story to hear from the wrestling community, which, you know, a lot of times on the news you hear a lot of negative stories, negative press, but this is one of those things that's uplifting. And he's actually going around telling people that a shark bit off his arm, and, you know, he's a jokester, I guess, but he's out here winning matches too. Like, not only is he out here making friends and just on the team or anything, he's out there winning matches, pinning guys. And there's a match in the news story, which I linked to below, where he pins his kid, he gets right up and he's smiling, he has a grin from ear to ear. But, you know, this isn't the first time that there's been a wrestler who has had a handicap. And you know, thinking back to the national championship in 2011, you had Anthony Robles, who beat Matt McDonough from Iowa to become a national champ. And I remember watching that match. He was so built. His upper body was so built. And that's where he gained a lot of his tactical position, I guess, because he didn't have one leg. He had to find another way to win. And of course, he did that whenever he beat Matt McDonough for that national championship. So good for you, Nick. And I'm glad that there are people who can now, you know, look up to you as an inspiration. Going on to the final news in wrestling this week, let's talk about the other matches. So one big match this week was at 184 pounds, Zach Zavatsky versus Nick Renan. And Zach Zavatsky, he ended up winning this match, beating Nick Renan. He won by a score of 6-2. Renan ended up in the first period. If you watch this match, Renan starts out, goes in, tries to get a headlock, doesn't quite, or he gets two. Zavatsky instantly reverses him, and those are the only points Renan scored in this match. Zavatsky pretty much controlled the rest of the match. You know, Zavatsky has had a few losses this season, but he is 22-3. He had losses to Drew Foster and Max Dean, but over the past, you know, couple of weeks, couple of months, he has had some solid wins over Chip Ness, Nino Bonacorsi, and Ryan Price. So he's had a couple quality wins this season, and Zavatsky's out here from Virginia Tech, is Zavatsky, and Renan's from NC State, but Zavatsky's out here to make some noise at Nationals, and I cannot wait. So in the next match, we have 133 pounds. Let's throw some more drama into the mix at 133 pounds, why don't you? Tariq Wilson decisions Corbin Myers. Now, this right now, neither of these guys are ranked in the top 10. However, they are ranked within the 10 to 15 range. And Tariq Wilson ended up, from NC State, beat Myers of Virginia Tech. This was in the same match as Zavatsky and Renan. So Tariq had a couple of nice takedowns, some riding time, and then he got a stupid hands to the face call, which is the absolute worst rule in wrestling this year. But what's great about this is Myers this year beat Mickey Phillippe. Mickey Phillippe beat Dayton Fix. And this past week, we know that Dayton Fix just beat Austin DeSanto. So Tariq Wilson, you know, do not take him lightly this year. Last year, he came alive in Nationals. He was unranked at the beginning of the tournament and ended up coming back, becoming an All-American, beating three, four, maybe even five ranked opponents throughout his tournament run, and he's out here to show you what he's got. So I cannot wait to see what Tariq has in store for us at the end of the season. In the last big match of the week, we had Matt Kolodzic take another loss. And of course, he lost to Ashnault a couple weeks ago at 149 pounds. Kolodzic from Princeton, Ashnault from Rutgers. But this week, Kolodzic, number two guy in the country now, was number one, lost to an unranked wrestler from Drexel. His name is Parker Krotman from Drexel. And this match, you know, it was a late takedown that Krotman got on Kolodzic to win the match. But, you know, what is the deal with this Kolodzic? Now, you're thinking about this, actually last year, Kolodzic also had a loss in February to an unranked wrestler from Brown. And then he, for the rest of the season, up in his conference championships, which he won into the national tournament, he did not lose until the national semifinals. So if Kolodzic does the same thing again this year, which is very possible, we're looking at a pretty solid run. And, you know, I said that's the last match, but there's one more I have to talk about. Jason Nolf, you know, Penn State wrestled against Buffalo this past week, and this guy got, Jason Nolf was riding a little bit too high. The kid from Buffalo got the reversal on him, pushed Nolf away instantly, like he's letting him up, like Nolf always does, and then he's like strutting himself around, and he's like, you know, he's like, oh yeah, he's taunting Nolf. What are you doing? What are you doing right now? Okay, so this, at 157 pounds, Nolf is the most dominant wrestler, hands down, and not just at 157 pounds, but Nolf is one of the most dominant wrestlers in the entire country right now. Do not taunt him. So Nolf, and what he ended up doing, he picked this kid right up, threw him in a cradle, and stuck him. And, you know, in the 10 seconds after he started taunting him, not a good look for you guys from Buffalo. Don't do that kind of stuff. You're just looking crazy. So let's move on to the fan questions this week. Make sure you leave all your comments and questions below so that I can answer them on a future show. This week, this question comes from Justin Thomas. And the question of the week, let's talk about Oregon wrestling. Oregon wrestling? That hasn't been around for years. Yeah, well, let's talk about it. So Justin Thomas asked if I can do a video about Oregon Ducks wrestling and why it was stopped. Well, Justin Thomas, thanks for asking the question. You're always coming up with great questions, and I appreciate that. So Oregon is in a similar situation to a lot of other Division I wrestling programs and D1 sports programs who were affected by, you guessed it, Title IX. And Title IX came about in the 1970s when, and if you don't know what Title IX is, essentially it brought a way to give more opportunity to women's sports, which I'm all for. That's great. But it did it at the expense of a lot of men's sports because there has to be an equal allocation of men's scholarships and women's scholarships. And so that's the real reason why Oregon wrestling was stopped. But let's not stop there. Let's actually look at the history of the program and what Oregon wrestling, what the Ducks were all about at the University of Oregon. So the program was cut actually not that long ago, 2007-2008 season. And the team at the time had a 7-12 record. So, you know, it was a losing record. Their team money and allocations ended up going towards other sports. Now, they actually had a few Pac-12 conference titles. Now, of course, in the Pac-12, you have Arizona State, you have Cal Poly, Stanford, Oregon State. Those are a couple of the teams in Pac-12. But this team actually dates back to the 1950s from all the research I was able to find in the history books. And I linked to all of my research and my history in the comments and in the description below so that you can check it out for yourself if you're interested. But this team dates back to the 1950s. They had a first Pac-12 conference title in 1975, and they had three total conference titles, 75, 81, and 82. They had pretty solid teams. They had 22 All-American wrestlers and 44 conference titles from their wrestlers at Oregon. The first All-American was Jay Deering in 1958. Jay Deering was the first All-American of Oregon wrestling, and he was fifth at 147 pounds. Of course, back then, the weights were different than they are now, but at 147 pounds, he had fifth. There were actually two champs from Oregon, and these champs are John Miller in 1969 at 115 pounds, which that seems very light right now for college wrestling, and Shane Webster, and he was the most recent national champion in 2006. Webster won at 184 pounds in the D1 wrestling national championships. And what did they reward him with 2 years later? Let's cut the program. Let's cut the program, even though we just had a national champ 2 years ago. How unfortunate, how unfortunate. But the last All-American was Joey Bracamonte, who placed in 2006 at 165 pounds. He placed the same year as Shane Webster. Unfortunate that they cut the program. But other notable wrestlers from Oregon, who you may or may not have heard of, most of them are retired fighters, or you know, they fought in UFC or Bellator, but they were MMA fighters. A couple of those guys, Evan Dunham, Greg Gibson, who is an All-American. He has actually also wrestled Greco at the Olympics for heavyweight. There's Kale Sonnen, who's another Olympic wrestler, and Sean Williams, who wrestled freestyle in the Olympics. But probably the most notable Oregon wrestler, and I thought this was so fun whenever I found this in my research, was this guy's name is Ken Casey. And if that name sounds familiar, you know, maybe it does, maybe it doesn't. But the reason that it would, because probably this sounds familiar, is One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest. And that is a very popular book and popular movie. It actually was nominated for a few Academy Awards back in the 2000s. But Ken Casey is the author of One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest, and he's an Oregon wrestler. So how about that? A couple of his achievements in wrestling: he was second at Pac-12. He was ranked in the top 10 of Oregon's all-time great wrestlers as far as winning percentage, and he wrestled in the 1950s. So Casey from One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest is a wrestler, and there are a lot of famous wrestlers actually that, you know, they don't, some of them do or don't flaunt their wrestling career. He's actually one who does, or who did, I should say. He liked to talk about his wrestling career. Now, the unfortunate thing, you know, I said that Title IX is the reason for why this stopped, and it is unfortunate. But, you know, this Title IX, there were, back in 1980s, there were 150 D1 programs. Now there are about 70. So it was cut back significantly, mostly based on Title IX and scholarships. But the funny thing is, you know, a lot of times people think it comes down to money, when it really doesn't. There have been a couple of attempts to raise money for the program. Casey, like I said, the author of One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest, he even liked to donate money back to the program. But Oregon football is one of the most highly profitable college football programs. In fact, I looked it up, and there's an article from Forbes from 2018. Oregon football is the 12th most valuable football program. And you want to know how much money they're bringing in? They're bringing in $92 million in revenue every year from their football program. And about $50 million of that is profit. So if there was any money to give out, you know, I'm sure they could spare a couple million for a wrestling team, but unfortunately that's not what it's about. Now, in the efforts over the past couple of years, there was actually a club wrestling team formed at Oregon in 2015 by Daniel Larman. And this, you know, you see this happen at a couple of schools. A lot of schools have club wrestling teams, and it's a great way to, you know, meet other guys who are similar to you in the sport of wrestling, and just forge you know, great friendships. And it's also a good way to stay active. But it's a nice little program in the Oregon club wrestling team. You know, could this become an actual wrestling team one day? Probably unlikely. You know, it could happen. There have been teams that there was a club team that became a varsity team. And actually, there's club hockey at Penn State. They were club hockey 5, 6, 7 years ago. They became a D1 varsity sport. We could see that happen with a couple of these programs. But, you know, that's it for Oregon wrestling and the history of Oregon wrestling. Thanks for asking that question. And make sure to leave all your questions and comments below so I can answer them in a future video. And that'll do it for this week's show. I mean, what an incredible week in wrestling. Cannot believe still that Spencer Lee got pinned. This is going to have a lasting impact for the rest of the season. I'm so pumped for the postseason, and I have a lot of fun and exciting content coming out for you guys to enjoy. Make sure if you're interested in this video that you share it with your friends and get them all to come to Fanco Wrestling, and make sure that you yourself subscribe to this channel so you can be updated every single week on the newest wrestling videos. Thanks for watching.